Hi, this is Annie Dance. I am an independent investigative journalist working to shine a light on police and policy issues in Lake Lure, Rutherford County, Western North Carolina, and beyond. Please subscribe if you haven't already to AnnieDance.substack.com, my Cops and Congress newsletter. Today, Wednesday, June 5th, 2024, I'm going to highlight a press conference that's going to begin shortly, or scheduled to begin shortly, I should say. Anything's possible at the North Carolina General Assembly. The NCGA, my segment here with today at the NCGA, highlights things that are happening in Raleigh that are live streamed but are not archived. I'm aiming to shine a light on these important issues because I feel, especially in Western North Carolina, it's difficult for the average citizen to know what's going on almost 4 hours away at the state capitol. So shortly, Senator Dan Blue is scheduled to give a press conference. I did see in today's NC Local News Workshops newsletter more information about the press conference, which is really interesting. So we'll see what he says, but there are more details, and I will share this link in the notes section. But to verbalize it for those who might be listening to this just on the audio section, on the audio side, especially if you're driving, please don't read this and drive. Please just listen. It says, news about the news, public records are the property of the people. Reporter Brian Anderson has the details in a proposed constitutional amendment to ensure public access to government records and meetings. NC Senators Greg Meyer and Dan Blue, Representatives Pricey Harrison, Diamond Stanton Williams, and others are holding a press conference today at 1 p.m. to unveil the bill. The amendment would enshrine in the state constitution that, quote, records made, transmitted, or received by public officials and agencies, including the executive, legislative, and judicial branches of state government and all bodies of local government, shall be open to public inspection, examination, and duplication, end quote. The measure would also prevent sweeping changes to public records laws and policies, as happened last year when lawmakers inserted language in the budget at the 11th hour that dramatically rolled back the public's access to records from state lawmakers and gave lawmakers the authority to destroy or even sell records they create. Because it's a constitutional amendment, it would need to be approved by voters. Quote, in the 8 months since the budget took effect, most lawmakers have taken advantage of their newfound power by refusing to respond to public records requests, let alone turn over any of their communications, writes Anderson, adding that when he asked all lawmakers to provide just one email of their choice, most didn't respond. You can, quote, you can't let the fox guard the hen house unless you just want to see feathers at the end of the day, unquote, Senator Democratic leader Dan Blue told Anderson. While the measure likely won't go anywhere, Anderson says it still matters. Quote, it's the first serious action anybody has taken to unravel the changes the new state budget made to public records laws, unquote. So there's more information to come, and we will see what the lawmakers say shortly with today at the NCGA.
Constitutional amendment that would guarantee the government, that guarantee the people of North Carolina the right to access of public records, the right to access to public meetings, to limit unwarranted, to have no unwarranted limitations on that access, and to try and make sure that it applies fully to the legislative branch, the executive branch, the judicial branch, as well as to local government bodies. It is my belief that the people of North Carolina, by and large, already believe that they have that right, that most folks already believe that in general, because they pay for the work that we do as their government, that they should have the right to public records and public meetings. And we are failing the public when we do not live up to that, and especially in the 2023 law, where we not only exempted ourselves as legislators from the law, but made it permissible by law for legislators to destroy or sell records. which I cannot imagine any reason why I would ever need to destroy or sell any of the records that I have from doing the public's business, other than to possibly hide records that show things that I don't want the public to have access to. And if that's the case, the public should absolutely have access to them. I also want to point out that this is not the first time that a constitutional amendment on public records has been introduced in the General Assembly. That in fact, in 2011, there were proposals for constitutional amendments introduced in both the Senate and the House by Republicans. And so today you see that these bills are being introduced by Democrats. But in doing our research, we actually went back and saw which Republicans had worked on this issue previously. And as you can see on this poster, Senate Bill 67 from 2011 had 23 Republican sponsors for a constitutional amendment on public records, including three that are still here with us today, Senators Heiss, Jackson, and Buck Newton. I approached all three of those senators, as well as Senator Berger, and asked them if they would co-sponsor this with Senator Blue and myself. They've declined at this time, but I am hopeful that in the future we'll be able to continue to work on what our shared interest is, given their previous stance and where we are today. Indeed, I would say that there is no better time than today to try and increase the public's right to public records and public meetings, because we stand at a crucial moment for sustaining some of the fundamental tenets of democracy. And if the public can't see what the public pays us to do, then we are failing the fundamental test the public expects of us. We have two additional speakers here today. Representative Tim Longest is here to speak for his perspective from the House of why they're supporting this bill. And then we have Ann Webb from Common Cause, who's been working on this as from a nonpartisan perspective. I'll turn it over to Representative Longest.
Thank you, Senator Meyer, and thank you all for being here today. Our state constitution's Declaration of Rights is basically the Bill of Rights for the citizens of North Carolina. It includes a simple but powerful proposition at the beginning. All political power is vested in and derived from the people. All government of right originates from the people, is founded upon their will only, and is instituted solely for the good of the whole. The amendment we file today guarantees the right to access public information and ensures that our state's government reflects the people's will. When the people elect us as their representatives, they elect us to a position of public trust. They empower us to act on their behalf, to come together to act in pursuit of the public interest. But in order for the people who elected us to hold us accountable, the people must have the right to know what we as their representatives are doing. That is why transparency in government is so important, and why we are introducing this constitutional amendment today. This amendment declares that the people have a right to access information concerning the conduct of the people's business. This right is so important and so fundamental to our form of government that we are placing it in the Declaration of Rights in Article 1. This amendment amounts to a reassertion of our founding principles that North Carolina's government belongs not to special interests, but to all the people. I urge my colleagues across the aisle to support this amendment. There have been several sunshine amendments introduced over the years, including by Republican members in 2011. This history shows that government transparency is a principle beyond party. It is not a Democratic idea or a Republican one, but an American one and a North Carolinian one. I ask my House colleagues in my own caucus and across the aisle to reassert their support of this foundational principle by signing on as co-sponsors of this amendment. This constitutional amendment is particularly important in a time of eroding trust in public officials and institutions. By enshrining the right to access public information in our state's constitution, we can ensure that the public is informed about the workings of government. And by shining the light of transparency, we allow everyday people to be more active and informed participants in our democracy. House Bill 1075 ensures accountability and transparency in government. I'm grateful for the work of Senator Meyer, Senator Blue, Representative Harrison, Representative Frather, and Staten Williams, and the advocates for good government who have pursued this amendment and fought for government transparency over the years. I'm also grateful for the press for their work in holding government accountable and ensuring that the public knows what we are doing. I'm honored to sponsor this amendment, and I hope my colleagues in the House will do the same. Thank you. And our next speaker will be Ann Webb, Policy Director with Common Cause.
Hi, I'm Ann Webb, Policy Director with Common Cause North Carolina. Common Cause is a nonpartisan grassroots organization dedicated to upholding the core values of American democracy, including open, honest, and accountable government that serves the public's interest. For more than 50 years, Common Cause North Carolina has worked with lawmakers from all political stripes to promote transparency and accountability in our state's government. Common Cause North Carolina applauds the introduction of this legislation guaranteeing the public's right to public records and meetings. This effort to promote the right to public records comes after some legislators sneaked provisions into last year's state budget that lets lawmakers hide important records from the public. These policy provisions were buried in the mammoth budget document that was made public less than 24 hours before it was voted on. These provisions, which are now law, would bar the public from having access to critical documents related to the essential work of the legislature, including the creation of North Carolina's voting districts. This new proposal would elevate public access to government records to a right under North Carolina's foundational document and require that statutes limiting public access be as narrow as possible. Especially as we've seen some politicians limiting public records access, it is time to put this question to the people. As this bill states plainly, public records are the property of the people, and the people of North Carolina have the right of access to information concerning the conduct of the people's business. This common sense legislation would help ensure the transparency needed for the public to hold public officials accountable. We urge the legislature to pass this proposal and allow North Carolinians to vote on the amendment this fall. Thank you.
Take some questions now. Ryan?
So I wanted to get y'all's perspective first. Everyone here has, to my knowledge, released some public records, but many lawmakers in both parties have not, including 22 House Democrats, 5 Senate Democrats, when asked to release just one email of their choice, did not. What would be your message to those folks who haven't responded to a request for even the most minimum transparency?
I mean, if you look at the history of the battle for public records access in North Carolina, you can see that it's not a partisan battle. It's not that one party has always been in favor of public records and the other party has always been opposed. It's really a battle between the public and the public officials, no matter which public officials are in charge. Those of us who are standing here today are saying we are taking the side of the public, that we believe that the public should have access to the records of all of us and everyone else who serves in government, whether it's at the state or local issue. That would apply to members of our own party as well as to members of the other party. If anybody else wants to join in on that, you're welcome to.
I would just, State Representative Lindsay Prather, Buncombe County. I would just add, I think the majority of legislators who do not respond to requests, I would guess that it's most likely an issue of the legislator, you know, looking at the request and deciding that I don't have anything that's going to be useful to this reporter, or what they're looking for is not something that, you know, that my information is going to help. I don't think that it's usually malicious intent or trying to hide something, but I think that's part of the point, right? Is that it shouldn't be up to us as individuals to determine what's important and what isn't.
Anybody else?
Senator Meyer, did you say that you had spoken to Berger and Moore concerning
the constitutional? I did not speak to Speaker Moore. I did speak to Senator Berger, and I did speak to the other three senators who were co-sponsors of the 2011 amendment, which was Heiss, Jackson, and Buck Newton. And none of them are interested in sponsoring this amendment at this time, but none of them also were, you know, fully committal about what's possible in the future. So I'm hopeful that in the future we'll be able to work together on this. I don't know if anybody spoke to Representative Moore about it or not.
Did they provide you with specific reasons why they were declining to be involved? Not at this time.
They did not. And unfortunately, one of the things that's difficult to answer when reporters ask it is what is our impression of the motivations of people who are not standing with us. So I'd encourage you to ask them directly.
We will be inviting all of our colleagues in the House to co-sponsor the amendment with us.
Hi. So I have two questions. The first one's just a quick clarification. I've just been keeping up with the website. And so I noticed that On the paper printed out, it shows sponsors, the primary sponsors being Blue, Senator Myers. On the website, it only lists Representative Harrison. Do you know if that is going to be updated? I just want to make sure that I have that
context. It should be Prather, Longest, and Dunn State Williams.
Okay.
I don't know. It needs an update.
Okay.
It was filed yesterday.
Yeah, no, that's no problem.
Yeah, I think the original print copy was just my request, and then we added the primary sponsor. So it's the four of us.
Okay. And then as for my follow-up question, so also per the website, it says that the amendment had passed its first reading, but now it's been referred to the Committee on Rules, Calendar, and Operations of the House. Would you be able to elaborate a little bit more about what that might mean for the future of the constitutional amendment?
Yeah, I think at this point in both chambers, all bills get referred to the Rules Committee as their first stop until the Rules Chairman decides whether to refer them to other committees. It certainly is possible that a constitutional amendment would only ever be heard in the Committee on Rules, Calendar, and Operations of the House or the Senate, because this constitutional amendment does apply directly to the rules, calendar, and operation of the chambers. That's where public records rest, is in the rules and operations of the chambers. So will we likely get a hearing on these in those committees this year? Probably not. But at some point when we do have the support that's necessary to move these forward, I would fully expect that the primary debate about whether this is an appropriate bill to move forward and place before the voters as a constitutional amendment, the place that should happen would be in the Rules Committee.
Thank you.
Brian.
Two others. Just for lawmakers who, to Representative Prather's point, might want to respond to a records request, you guys are lawmakers, you've all responded to records requests. Can you walk a lawmaker through what that entails and what should be done in your eyes when someone does receive a records request?
Are you asking, can we walk our fellow lawmakers through that, or
if most of them haven't responded to a records request for one email of their choice, presumably they're just either ignoring it or don't know how to do it.
Okay, then I guess the answer to your question is yes, we can. We cannot guarantee they will comply. I mean, one of the challenges that you face and that we face in working in a legislative system and even within caucuses is every member is an independently elected official. No one is beholden to their caucus over their voters. And this is part of why we want to put a constitutional amendment to the vote, is we want this to be clear that people are beholden to the will of the voters. And voting to put it into the constitutional amendment or into the Constitution would be even more powerful than having a reporter ask for it.
I was just going to say, I think the hope would also be that if the amendment passes, that we are then able to create a better system so that it ideally bypasses the individual legislator. I mean, obviously, there are things that we need to protect, constituent names and addresses and specific personal details, once we take this step of adding it to the Constitution, I think we then have more of a mandate to create a much more efficient system to get access to those records.
I'll echo that, and I'll just say that I think that the way the exemption works is by removing records from the Public Records Act for us and leaving it up to each legislator, it creates a very blurry definition of what is and is not a public record. We want to start from a place where everything done in the name of the people and concerning people's business is a public record. The amendment will permit, if there's a compelling reason and a compelling public interest behind withholding a record, a government agency could put that forward, but the presumption should be that the record is public.
Just to anybody's knowledge, has any lawmaker that you guys are aware of sold or destroyed communications since that's a new power? If so,
who?
Right. I mean, that's what's problematic about the provision that allows legislators to sell and destroy records is by doing either one of those things, no one else would ever know that it was done. I will say this about that provision. I think that most of our Republican colleagues understand why that particular piece of last year's law is problematic. I think that furthermore, they probably agree with us that that was an overplay of their hand in the restriction of the records and allowing them to be destroyed or sold. And so if there is an opening at any point in time, and we can look for openings even in amending bills to try and put a restriction on last year's law, that would probably be the simplest and agreement that we could find, would be to eliminate that specific language about the sale and destruction of records. I do have one thing I forgot to pass them out, but I do have copies of the 2011 constitutional amendment if anybody wants a copy of that to be able to look at it. And if you have additional questions, we'd be happy to take them outside when we're done. Thank you for being here, and thank you to all of the sponsors and co-sponsors and colleagues for working on these bills. And glad to see you today. Have a good day.
There you have it, directly from lawmakers. I find it very troubling that even some of these Democratic lawmakers are stating things like they will allow for certain provisions, including names of constituents. You heard Representative Prather from Buncombe County say she's in favor of basically not allowing the names of constituents to be released. I find that problematic on several levels. I could see perhaps limiting certain identifying features such as an address or a phone number, but I believe names and emails should be available in all public records, so you have a full picture of who exactly is involved and who exactly is asking the questions, and an email address to follow up if you have additional questions or clarification needed. And then finally, Senator Meyer just stated that he would take questions outside. The purpose of a press conference like this is to take the questions during the press conference. My background is as a journalist for over 20 years. I got my start covering police and government officials after 9/11 when I was in college. I have worked for several different news organizations, but in rural Western North Carolina, working for myself with my Substack is the best use of my time. And I'm over almost 4 hours away one way from Raleigh. I can't physically be there. Even if I had the funding, to be honest, I wouldn't want to drive there. Why would I want to drive there when I can work remotely and get the same information? So I think these lawmakers really need to take that into account, that not everyone can travel to the state capitol when you have such a huge, huge state. So I find that very, very interesting and very problematic, as I said. But we'll see what happens. I don't know, as another question brought up, where it goes from here, if it's in the House rules. But that was also interesting hearing the 2011 co-sponsors of the bill then, including State Senator Ralph Hise, who covers many counties in Western North Carolina. So stay tuned, more details to come as they develop. Thanks for watching. See you next time.